And the Lord will send that word to us as I welcome to the altar our brother, our father, Pastor Akiru.
Surrounds Jerusalem, so is the Lord round about his people and henceforth and forevermore. Father, we thank you for your divine presence around us. Father, we thank you for shielding us. Heavenly Father, we give you all the glory as the word is coming forth from the altar this morning. Father, let there be divine manifestation. Father, every issue that has fallen your people into this place will not go back with them. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. By the service of this day, let there be healing. Let there be deliverance. Let there be manifestation of your power. Let people receive everything that they've been looking upon your face for. Father, we pray that for everyone in this place who has been waiting for a long time, by the word of this morning, the waiting time is over. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Every depressed heart in this place this morning, I declare the word will bring encouragement to you.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
For everyone that has fallen, by the summer of this morning, the Lord will lift you up.
Amen.
The grace to trust in the Lord and to follow him, even when we don't know where he's leading us. Father, you give it unto
Amen.
Us this morning. Father, we thank you because you answered our prayers. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Let somebody just shout hallelujah. God bless you. Thank you so much. We're going to be reading a lot of Bible passages this morning, and everything is coming from the book of Judges chapter 6. I'm still on the topic, go through to breakthrough. You can call this the part 2 of this sermon. But before I go further, I just want to kind of do a recap of everything that we spoke about during the last week's Sunday. During the last week's Sunday, I said, if you can't go through it, then you can't break through it. It's scriptural. This is not a word that I profess from my own mouth. So if you don't have a go-through experience, you don't expect a breakthrough manifestation. So if you run away from battle, if you dodge battle, then you dodge breakthrough. If you run away from battles, you run away from breakthrough, because breakthroughs are embedded in battles. Breakthroughs are embedded in pains, in disappointment, in discouragement, in everything that we go through in life. I want to tell you this morning that if you don't have a battle that you're going through, then you are not a threat to the camp of the enemy. Or maybe your eyes has not been opened to see the battle so that you can attack and fight it. Because at the end of the battle is the breakthrough.
Amen.
It's only when you go through the battle that you experience the breakthrough. So last week's Sunday was more like a motivation for us to always face the battles that we fight, instead of us running away from the battles. And we read through the book of Judges chapter 6. And we're still going to be dealing with that particular book of Judges today. And the reason why Gideon was able to fight against the Midianites was because he obeyed God. After he obeyed God, he was able to face the battle. See, I want to tell you, church, this morning, are you going through some trials in your life and you feel within you that you don't have the power to fight this battle? Yes, it's always like that. We all feel that way because we're wired to think that our success is directly proportional to the strength that we have. When you go for interview, they tell you that these are your strengths, these are your weaknesses. But deep within you, you know that sometimes the things that they call your weaknesses are the things that you even do easily. So Gideon never saw himself as a mighty man of battle, even when God called him a mighty hero. So if you are in the church this morning and you feel that this battle is weighing you down, and the only thing you do is to complain about the battle, just like Gideon was doing, I congratulate you, because God has enabled you to go through the battle, because the inner strength is within you already to fight and win the battle.
Amen.
So I pray for you this morning that every battle of your life, as you go through it, you will win through it.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. As you go through it, you will win through it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Now, I want us to know this morning that one of the reasons why we are always afraid to take on challenges in our life is that we don't trust God. And trust is so important to our ability to excel in the battles of life. The Bible said in Psalm 141, 125, it said, they that trust in the Lord shall be like Mount Zion that cannot be removed. You cannot be removed. That is the word of the Lord for you. Now, the basic requirement for you to enjoy and stand is for you to trust in the Lord. When you don't trust in Him and you trust in your friend, you trust in your strength, you trust in your ability to do some things, I want to tell you that you don't excel in those things because your strength will carry you to a point of success. And, you know, when you get to that point, you will need the Spirit of God to carry you further. There is a limitation to how far you can go by yourself. I want us to open quickly to the book of Judges chapter 6. And I want to tell us 5 points this morning, or 5 lessons that will help us to trust God more. And all these 5 lessons are coming from this book of, from the book of Judges chapter 6, which is the story of Gideon. And the first one that I want to talk about is this: God uses tough times to get our attention. God uses tough time to get our attention. Can somebody please open the book of Judges chapter 6, verses 1 to 6? I need somebody who can read the Bible first. Judges chapter 6, verses 1 to 6.
Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord.
Yes.
So the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Midian for 7 years.
For 7 years.
And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel because of the Midianites. The children of Israel made for themselves the dens, the caves, and the strongholds which are in the mountains. So it was, whenever Israel had sown, Midianites would come up, also the Amalekites, and the people of the east would come up against them. Then they would encamp against them and destroy the produce of the harp as far as Gaza, and leave no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor donkey. For they will come up with their livestock and their pets, coming in as numerous as locusts. Both they and their camels were without number, and they would enter the land to destroy it. So Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord.
They cried out to the Lord. Now look at what happened in verse 1. The Bible said, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of God. Sometimes we are consumed by what we love. Sometimes we are consumed by things that actually take us away from God. Sometimes I want you to know, children of God, the best way that God will get our attention is for Him to take us through trials. So when you're going through trials and you've tried everything possible and you are not able to solve the problem on your own, then you turn to God. The Bible said the Lord delivered them to the hand of their oppressors. There was no way that the children of Israel could withstand the Midianites in their numbers of armies and everything. You don't know what the Bible said. The Bible said whenever they come to invade the land of Israel, that they come in multitude. The Bible said they are as thick as locusts. That is, whenever they come in, there is no space for anything to pass in between them. And they devour the land of Israel for straight 7 years. Now, as long as you're still in that battle and you're still fighting on your own, you know, the affliction will continue. But immediately you turn to God, God will hear your voice and He will take over the battle and He will fight on your behalf. What I want you to know this morning is that God doesn't send battles to kill you. He sends those challenges into your life so that He can gain your attention. He wanted the attention of the children of Israel, so He allowed the enemy to overpower them. So whatever you find yourself today, ask God that, God, what are you speaking to me in this situation that I find myself? That's the reason why Gideon was saying to the angel that this is not what God promised them. It is true that that wasn't what God promised them. But God cannot take them through the promise until He went through their heart. So if you are living a life that is not conformed with the word of God, and things are not going well today, I need you to kneel down and say, Father, you are speaking something to me that I still need to understand. Whenever what you see what happens to you is not what God has promised for your life, you need to go on your knees. Until you go on your knees and commit everything to Him, you don't see the blessing that He has promised you. I want somebody quickly to open to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11 to 12. Proverbs 3, 11 to 12.
My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of His corrections. For whom the Lord loveth, He corrected.
For whom the Lord loveth. Another version says, whom the Lord loveth, He disciplined. Continue.
Even as a father, the son in whom He delighted. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding. For the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof that find gold.
There's another version that ended our word.
She is more precious than rubies, and all the things thou canst desire are not to be compared unto her. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. We're talking about wisdom there. But what I want to bring out of that particular passage is actually in the book of Proverbs 3, 11 to 12. God, He said, do not despise the Lord's instruction. Do not. He said, my son, and do not loathe His discipline, for the Lord disciplines the ones that He loves. Just as a father, the son, He delights in. Now, God loves us so much that He won't just allow us to go through trouble for nothing. See, if things are not going well today, there is an inbuilt strength and power in you that you need the Holy Spirit of God to collide with and to expand it. So, the fruit of the Spirit that is not manifested is just lying fallow within you. So when God wants to bring out the best in us, He allows our enemy to afflict us. That does not mean that God does not care for us. That does not mean that God does not love us when tough times come. Instead of looking at them as if God is punishing us, try to see it as God's gift of grace. If they can kill you, they would have killed you a long time ago. If the situation can kill you, you won't be alive today. For the fact that you are alive today, it's because God has a plan and a purpose for your life. But until you see it, you're not walking to it. Have you been in a situation where you're in the class and your instructor is explaining something to you? And you've done everything, you didn't understand, and suddenly you just understand, you say, I see. I see. Now you couldn't see actually, but you could discern with your heart. Now I see. Now I understand. There's something that is called connecting the dots for people that went through business school. When you go through some journeys in your life, always look back. There is always a link between your present location and where you're coming from. Now, when you go through that trial and you come out, you will relate back to the things that you have gone through, you will connect the dots, and then you will know that God has actually been doing amazing things in your life all the while. When you will be a comforter to people that are in trial, you will go through trial, because if you don't go through, you won't understand them. See, I tell you, when you call yourself a counselor, I ask you, what kind of trouble have you gone through before? Because if you have not gone through, you won't understand. Experience is the best teacher. You can't read book and counsel me, because you're not feeling it. It's like calling myself, or say, describing the pain of childbirth to women. There's no way I can describe the pain of childbirth to women. They're gonna look at me like, what's he talking about? What's he talking about? So God, let's see, I got one quote from C.S. Lewis. He said, God whispers to us in our pleasures. He speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. He is His megaphone to roast a deaf word. He shouts in our pain. That is where we hear him more. The best of us will come in the days of our pain. And the gift of Joseph multiplied in the prison. Before he used to sleep, before he dreamed, but when he got to the prison, he wasn't sleeping anymore. He started seeing visions. I pray that the Lord Almighty will give us the grace and the opportunity to trust him in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, the reason again why you need to trust God more, number two, is that God sees more than we do. Can somebody read again? Judges chapter 6, verses 7 to 12. Judges 7, 6, 7 to 12.
Now it came to pass about when they cried out to the Lord because of Midian, the Lord sent a prophet to the Israelites, and he said to them, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I brought you home from Egypt. I brought you out of the house of slavery. And I rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians and from the hands of all those who oppressed you. I drove them out before you and gave you the land. 10. And I said to you, I am the Lord your God. You shall not fear the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you live, but you have not listened to and obeyed my voice. 11. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the Trebonite tree of Ophrah, which belonged to Joash, the Abrezrite, and the son of Gideon, was beaten with it in the winepress, instead of the threshing floor, to hide it and save it from the Midianites. Verse 12. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, the Lord is with you, O brave man.
O brave man. Take note of that word, O brave man. And take note of this second point that God sees more than we do. Now, do you know what a threshing floor means? Do you know what a wine press actually means? A wine press is a place that is hidden. And a threshing floor is a place that is in the open. When you're threshing wheat, you need the wind to blow the chaff from the actual wheat. Now, Gideon was hiding to thresh wheat. How will he get wind inside the wine press to thresh the wheat? And you know the reason why? Because he was afraid. Now, take this again. A brave man in the sight of God was afraid of the battle. A mighty man, a mighty hero in the sight of God was afraid of the challenges that were ahead of him. Most of the time we run away from our battle because we believe that we don't have the ability to fight the battles. And therefore the devil himself, because he sees in the spirit also, he sees that we have been endowed, but he always blocks our eyes to see the strength that God has imputed in us. So now, all what I need you to do, church, is that always see with the eyes of God. When you see yourself as a small man, you don't leave that position as a small man. That's the reason why the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you say you can't make it, then you can't. The first black president of the United States of America, he said, yes, we can. The house was a White House, but he lived there for 8 years. After 4 years, they've not been able to wake up from their dream, and they said, we will block him from having another 4 years. And then he said, yes, we can still. And he got another 4 years again. And this man wrote a book, he called it The Audacity of Hope. And his life is an inspiration to young people that you can attain whatever you have put your hand to do, because you don't know, you don't see how big you are until God opens your eyes to see the things that he has imputed into you. I used to attend a church in Nigeria. The church was still very small then. We put our handkerchief on our head, we say, bless you. And then another time we say, the word works. And the minister, the man of God said, just say it throughout that the word works. The word works. So if you say the word works, that means whenever you read the Bible, you already know that this word actually works. A lot of us will read the Bible as a storybook, and then the story will continue to manifest. We even dream of the story. Because it's like a story to us. Mary came back to Jesus Christ, a storybook. No, it happened live and direct. When you start seeing yourself in the same eyes that God sees you, you will know that you have been empowered. Now, one of the things that the angel spoke unto Gideon, he said, go in the power that you have. So the power to do great exploits is in you. All you need to do is to tap into this power by connecting with God, your maker. When a young man or a young lady or an old man or whatever, whenever you are born again, you are already aligned with the promise of God. But it's now left for you to allow the fruit of the Holy Spirit to align with your internal belief system so that you can continue to operate in the supernatural. When you give your life to Christ, you are not just an ordinary man anymore. You are a force to be reckoned with. So God sees him as a mighty man. But the mighty man was afraid. How many of you are afraid this morning? You are even afraid of the next step you want to take. I said it here. A lot of people are even afraid of getting into a relationship. A lot of people are afraid of even asking their parents that they need this thing. When I was in school, I don't just ask my father that I need anything. He's a pastor, but I can control him because he doesn't know what I'm doing. He doesn't know the details of the prayer that I pray. Father, I ask that you go touch his hand. He has the money, it's not an issue at all. He doesn't have one. Yes. And I don't want to hear stories. When I say I need them, you will send. And then you will send. But when you just go with you're not even bold, you're just saying that I need money. The responsibility of your parents is to provide for your need. And it's like asking God something you don't ask as if he's not your father. God sees you bigger than you see yourself. No matter how much you think you know about yourself, you can't know enough. And the only way to know about yourself is to connect with the one that has created you. He has a manual. He can show you why he created you. Every man has a purpose. Every woman has a purpose. You have been called to fulfill a need. There is always a need on the earth. And that's the reason why you are brought here. If you are not useful to him, he doesn't have any business bringing you here. So he brought Gideon. And Gideon never see himself as a mighty man, but God saw him as a mighty man. How do you see yourself today? Just think about it. Are you a great man? Are you a great woman? Are you one of the people that will influence your generation? If you believe you can, then you can. If you believe you can't, then we need to pray. Because if you can't see greatness in yourself, no one will see greatness in you. When you have a vision, take note of this. People around you will never believe in you. That's how you will know that God actually gave you a vision. If everybody is not following you, it's not yet a vision. A vision must be contended with. When you are given a vision, you are left alone because nobody will believe you. Because nobody was there when God gave you that vision. So people will never believe you. You know the reason why? Because they see how you have walked in the past. And they have predicted your future, that this is how far you can go based on the things that has happened in the past. But the Bible says when the Lord turned against the captivity of Zion, that they were like them that dreamed. I pray that the Lord will open your eyes, just like he opened the eyes of Gideon, and you will see what lies ahead of you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Now, God confirmed his priority with his presence. God confirmed his priorities with his presence. That's the third one. I want somebody to read the book of Judges chapter 6 from verse 13 to 24. Verse 13 to 24.
And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befalling us? And where be all his miracle, which our father told us of, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivers us into the hands of the Midianites.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. See, please hold on 1 minute. I want to draw something out of that particular verse that we just read. You know what Gideon said? He said, if the Lord be with us, I need you to say to yourself that the Lord is with me.
The Lord,
the Lord is with me.
The Lord is with me.
No matter the trial that I go through, the Lord is with me. See, God does not leave his children. He loves us so much. Now, in the eyes of Gideon, God had already forsaken the children of Israel. But no, God did not. He didn't forsake them. He loved them so much. And you know what we read in the book of Proverbs chapter 3 verse 11? The Bible said the people that God loves, he disciplines. The reason why some people don't dip their hands into sin is because they know that even if my people go for this sin, they will catch them. You will be caught, and then you start asking yourself that why is it that people are doing this thing and you know nobody is stopping them. When I do it, I get into trouble. It's because God loves you. And he always used that situation to discipline you. I want us to continue.
Verse 14. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of
the Midianites. Go in this thy might. The Bible did not say God just breathed upon him and he received strength. Do you understand me, church? The Bible did not say God just touched him and said, receive strength to win this battle. Most of us, we pray. I also pray that Father, give me the strength to fight the battles of my life. See, the strength is already in us. Whenever we give our life to Christ and we allow the works of the Holy Spirit to manifest in us, then it jumpstarts the deposit that is already in us. That's the reason why the Holy Spirit functions in us in different ways. So when you receive the Holy Spirit, the way that you manifest is different from the way that I manifest, because we have been endowed and strengthened with different gifts. The reason why some people can stay and work with children's class, those people did see something you don't see as gift. They're actually gifts. Some people are in children's class now controlling them. I bet you I can't spend 2 minutes in that place. I'll be tempted to hit somebody's bum. Because, see, but these people are patient, even when the children are some assaulting, jumping all around, they still, you know, corner them and, you know, pamper them and everything like that. It's not everyone that has that kind of patience. You know what you do to your children? Whenever they misbehave. Can we continue?
And thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I have Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite the Midianites
as one man. Wait. See his resume. He said, let's go through verse 15 again. He said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? I'm not qualified based on my resume. Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. Apart from the fact that his family is poor, can you imagine your family is the least in a tribe, and you are now the least in the family? He said, based on my resume, I am not qualified to fight this battle. A lot of you are not qualified for Judges. They will call you for it.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
They will call you.
Amen.
Amen.
See, some of you will be hired in a lower position in a job, and they will fire people that are ahead of you.
Amen.
And they will just push you here.
Amen.
Because you have the desire to do the will of God. You don't need to be sending resume to apply. A time is coming. A time is coming that people will tap you in the shoulder and they will tell you that there is a job here. Are you interested?
Amen.
See, there are jobs, there are blessings. Oh. If you want to work, there are work. Jobs. Where you work from morning till evening and your body will ache you. Those are jobs. But when God gives you blessings,
amen.
Even you yourself, you will know that this job is too simple for what they are paying me. I pray that that blessing will be your portion.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I pray that that blessing will be your portion.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want you to speak to yourself this morning and say, I am blessed, I am not called.
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 In the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let's continue.
Verse 17. And he said unto him, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. Depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee, and bring forth my present, and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry unto thou come again. And Gideon went in and made ready a heap, and unleavened cakes of an ephah of flour. The flesh he put in a basket, and he put the broth in a pot, and brought it out unto him under the oak, and presented it. And the angel of God said unto him, take the flesh and the unleavened cake, and lay them upon this rock, and pour out the broth. And he did so. Then the angel of the Lord put forth the end of the staff that was in his hand, and touched the flesh and the unleavened cake, and there rose up fire out of the rock, and consume the flesh and the unleavened cakes. Then the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. And when Gideon perceived that he was an angel of the Lord, Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for because I have seen an angel of the Lord face to face. And the Lord said unto him, peace be unto thee, fear not, thou shalt not die. 24. Then Gideon built an altar there unto the Lord, and called it Jehovah Shalom. Unto this day it is yet an offer of Abiezer.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The God of peace will grant you peace in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Lord will grant you peace from every enemy of your life in Jesus' name. Now, I said that God confirmed his priorities with his presence. Now, when God's word came to, Gideon, look at his skills, his abilities. That's what we look for in resumes today. What have you done before that makes you qualify for this position? What are the skills that you have? And he gave all his resume qualifications to God. And God did not even answer what he was saying. Sometimes we speak and God doesn't answer because those words are meaningless to him. He doesn't waste his time. Father, I'm not qualified for this, but to send another person. That's not what you want to hear. The Bible said in verse 16, and the Lord said unto him, surely I will be with thee. That makes the difference. When God goes with you, everything goes well for you. When God is with you, let there be billions of battalions standing against you. You will wreck them all. See, people that understood the presence of God going with them, they said it in the Bible. Moses said, me go in the wilderness without your presence? I can't try it. He said, if you will not go with these people, then we're not going anywhere. The presence of God signifies power. He said, you will strike the Midianites as one man. Now, when the presence of God goes with you, you fight like a battalion of soldiers, even though you are one man. So God confirmed his priorities with his presence. Whenever God goes with you into any battles of your life, you come back singing songs of praise. Because it's always breakthrough on the way. So when God is saying, I will be with you, and you are saying, I'm not ready to go through, how do you want to experience breakthrough? You must trust God by his word. Gideon asked for an encounter in order for him to believe that God actually meant that he should go into the battle. How many times have you prayed that God show me a sign that you're actually leading me? It's biblical. You can ask God for a sign. When a man says, I love you, and you are afraid, go to God and say, Father, show me a sign that this is the man. You can even tell God the sign that you want. And God is always faithful. He will show you. If you are committed, if you don't have a prepared answer in your mind, and say, Father, show me this person. It's the person I've chosen, or you don't have to change. You don't need to say that God sees through the heart. He knows what you want, even though you're praying. Father, I have two jobs. Father, show me the one I should take. You already know that this one with the highest money is the one you want to take. I pray the Lord will give us understanding. Amen. Now, the fourth one is private faithfulness is a prerequisite for public usefulness. Private faithfulness. Can somebody read from the same chapter, verse 25 to 32? Verse 25 to 32.
And it came to pass the same night that the Lord said unto him, take the father's young bullock,
yes,
even the second bullock of 7 years old, and throw down the altar of Baal that thy father had, and cut down the grove that is by it, and build an altar unto the Lord thy God upon the top of this rock in the other place, and take the second bullock and offer a burnt sacrifice with the wood of the proof which thou shalt cut down. Then Gideon took 10 men of his servants and did as the Lord had said unto him. And so it was, because he feared his father's household and the men of the city, that he could not do it by day, that he did it by night. And when the men of the city arose early in the morning, behold, the altar of Baal was cast down, and the groove was cut down that was by it, and the second bullock was offered upon the altar that was built. And they said one to another, who has done this thing? And when they inquired and asked, they said, Gideon, the son of Joash, hath done this thing. Then the man of the city said unto Joash, bring out thy son, that he may die because he had cast down the altar of Baal, and because he had cut down the groove that was by it. And Joash said unto all that stood against him, will ye plead for Baal? Will you save him? He that will plead for him, let him be put to death while it is yet morning. If he be a god, let him plead for himself,
yes,
because one has cast down his altar. Therefore, on that day he called him Jerubbaal, saying, let Baal plead against him, because he hath thrown down his altar.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, private faithfulness is a prerequisite to public usefulness.
Amen.
See, when God wants to use you to influence the life of people, the first thing he does is to clean you up. And now the process of cleaning could be very painful. And that's still the go-through that we talk about. You can't change me until you change yourself. The change has to come from the inside of you before it can influence your children, your husband, your wife, and then it will continue to multiply and influence your community. See, God takes us through some things in life to prepare us for the journey that he has ahead of us. You know, there was no way Gideon could have success in battle when he was, you know, going against the commandment of God that thou shalt not worship another God beside me. The father was keeping an idol in their company. Those idols, they also contain with the destiny of Gideon. In fact, that is the reason why they were the leader, the poorest in the tribe of Manasseh. Because the idol was sitting down with them. How many idols are you keeping in your life today? What are the sins that you are hiding? The Bible says, he that covereth his sin shall not prosper. Those things that you are hiding within you will prevent your journey in life. That's the reason why the Bible says, except a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. See, some of you, you think that the kingdom of God is when you get to heaven. So the kingdom of God actually starts from this end. Some people are living a very good life, serving God. They are rich, they have more than what they needed because they obey the word of God that put all these things away and give me the rest of your life. So if God cannot, if you can't allow God to clean you up in the private, he won't bring you out to be used in the public. If you can't deal with your own sin, you can't deal with the sins of other people. That's the reason why we continue to shout that you need to change your life. When you change your life, you become a change agent to the lives of people that God had already connected with you. And until you change your life, the fruit of the Spirit that is within you will never reveal himself. And until the fruit reveals himself, you're not connected with people that has been ordained to lead your destiny and to help you become a better person in life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's just be on our feet. Lord, help me to trust in you. As he said, our Father, help me to trust in you. I'm going back to Psalm 125 again. He said, they that trust in the Lord, they shall be like Mount Zion, that cannot be removed. He said, like the mountain surrounds Jerusalem. So the Lord is a surrounding. Just speak to the Lord this morning and say, Father, help me to trust in you. Father, help me to go through the battles of life, believing that I already won the battle. Father, help me to trust in you. Draw me close to you. Father, never let me down. I want you to speak to the Lord and continue to, you know, commit yourself unto him and speak to him. Never let me down.